Hello everyone, Cradox here, and welcome back to tier listing everything in Factorio. So, in our first episode, we did the logistics tab, and now we are moving on to the automation tab. And it's going to be a good time. Yeah, like we said in the last video, we have some grading criteria down here at the bottom. I'm not weighting them all equally, and sometimes I mainly only care about one or two of those categories for a particular thing. A lot of this is subjective, of course, which is why it's fun, so we can all argue about it. So let me know what you think in the comments about these rankings, but we're gonna dive straight in with the classic. And I just want to remind everybody, oh, I need to change the colors here, that C is the default. C is not bad. C is not a bad grade. C is where everything goes unless I have a good reason to move it somewhere else. So that's how that works. This is orange. And this is red. And this is gray. Okay. So, assembler one. I mean, I think it belongs solidly in C tier, right? Like, You replace it really early with blue assemblers. I actually think this is one of those instances where I just had like 50 thoughts at once and they all tried to get out of my mouth at the same time, so I just said nothing. Because I was thinking about, we talked a little bit about quality in the last episode and how an alternative, well, I've talked about this separately, I don't even think I mentioned it, but an alternative to the quality mechanic could have been adding more tiers of things, right? Rather than having quality as a mechanic, you find the specific buildings and entities where you need something a little bit better in the late game, like assemblers, and you just make an assembler tier 4, right? But then my thought about this was, do we really need tier 1 and 2? Like, does this really, like, it's 50% faster, which isn't, I mean, it's a boost, but it's not that big of a boost. It's still pretty cheap. So as soon as you get the blue ones, you're making them instead of the gray ones. Like, do the gray ones really serve that much of a purpose? And I think this might have been true more before Space Age, right? But now that we have Space Age, there's so much game past the blue assembler that the existence of the gray assembler almost feels useless. Because it's only a part of the game for such a short little time that compared to the rest of the game that it's like, what if we just started with one and we didn't get an upgrade for a while? You know, would that really change the game that much? Like, let's say you just had blues only and they even cost the same as a gray. Would that really change the game that much? It feels good to get the upgrade to blue when you do. I'm just questioning the need for the existence of the gray in the first place. Like, what if you just only had the blue, you started with the blue, and it cost the same thing? Now that we're in Space Age, would that really feel all that weird? I don't think it would. That's my hot take. So I think grays are D because you replace them so fast. And I mean, yes, they're cost effective and you sort of rush them because they're the only way to automate anything. So conceptually, you know, all the assemblers are S tier, right? Because you need to make things in Factorio. These are Factorio, right? But in a more comparative sense, I think the grays are pretty low. Yeah, I mean, you rush gray because they're the only thing that can do it. I actually specifically left off of my list of criteria. I left off the word necessity because lots of these buildings are 100% necessary to progress the game and move forwards. But I don't think it should get an A just because you have to build it, right? I don't think the necessity of a gray assembler means it should be graded higher. Yeah, the iconicness of it is pretty high, but I think that's true of all three of these. You probably see more pictures with these in them. You see pictures of starter bases with these, but you see pictures of late game bases with these. I think something like this kind of makes sense, you know? These are standard, you play with them for a long time, but as soon as you can get yellows, you replace them. There's no real reason to keep using the blues at all once you have the yellows. Oh, here's the fun one. Are they yellow or are they green? That's the real question. Argue in the comments. All right, for whatever reason, lightning rods came to my eye, though they are planet specific, which kind of gets into other types of conversations too. But I'm going to put that at F tier because I think it's a completely unnecessary entity. I never built one, first of all, and you really don't need to unless you're running out of power, at which point you just build them because they soak up a larger percentage of lightning. I think they could have just had this one soak up 40% by default. Would the game have been any worse? I doubt it. Like, this felt like a really unnecessary having two tiers of something where you only need one to me. It just... By the time I needed any more power than what these provided... What am I trying to say? Like, again, this is, it's kind of like my argument for gray and blue. Like, why do we need two tiers here when this tier is already more than good enough for everything you need to do for a long time on Glaive, on Fulgora, to the point where by the time you have these, you're just doing it for the slight boosts, at which point you could have just had the quality bonuses for this be higher, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Like, I don't know. It just felt unnecessary to have two tiers. That's the point I'm making. Accumulators were the bottleneck. Exactly, Monotest. That's the point I'm trying to make. Accumulators are the thing that are slowing down your power, not these things. Yeah, and the big ones have a larger range, but again, does that mean we needed another one of them, or could they have just made the range a little longer on these? Like, is it a necessary upgrade, or could we have just made the base ones better? Like, is there a sense of we need the player to feel like the lightning rods were really weak when I landed on Fulgora, but then after I played on Fulgora for a little bit and got Fulgora and science packs, now I have the strong lightning rods and everything's different now. Like, that's not, it's like, okay, I guess I'll put the strong ones because I can. It just feels really, I don't know why I'm feeling so strongly about this right now, but I feel like this second tier of lightning rod is completely unnecessary. So they get an F. These get a C because they do what they need to do. I found lightning to be a pretty boring mechanic overall. Graphics wise and sound wise, incredible. Even conceptually, it's really cool, like a lore wise sense. But the actual gameplay of it is very boring. You place the lightning rods so that your whole base is covered with coverage, and that's it. There's zero like intrigue or nuance, or you different players might do it differently. It's like, no, everybody just places the lightning rods. That's it. That's all there is to it. And once you place the lightning rods, you now have, unless you're building a really crazy base, you have enough power. You just need to build more accumulators until you can collect it. So overall, lightning felt like a fairly weak mechanic. It was very cool in terms of the design and the look and stuff. I just wish it had a little bit more play to it mechanically. Yeah, it's like a puzzle that's way too easy to solve. It's like, oh cool, a puzzle, and then you open it and it's a four-piece puzzle and you're like, well, the corner pieces go here, I guess I'm done. And you know, you didn't need to spend barely any time using the Fulgoran lightning rods that were already planted for you. You know, you could build these really easily and really fast. So it felt weird. It felt too easy. Yeah. All right. Moving on. Blueprints. Let's rank these, because these are a really interesting thing to rank. I think blueprints deserve... Well, no. It's hard because there's different concepts here, but I think blueprints need S tier. Because they're what part of what makes Factorio Factorio is that you can easily build massive factories, and that would not be possible without blueprints. And copy-pasting is just an extension of blueprints and deconstruction planners. So I'm kind of putting these together as one thing. I do think they're separate though, and I'm glad that they're separate things in the game. The deconstruction planner and being able to filter it is a really amazing mechanic. And the blueprint planner, and now you can parameterize them in such a way that when you paste your blueprint, it asks you questions about what you want it to look like. I mean, it's just amazing. It's just amazing. And not having any limits. There's no limits on how big you make them. Like in Satisfactory, you can just make whatever you want into a blueprint and you can modify it. You can remove, I mean, all the ability, what you can do with it is incredible. Like being able to change the tiling of it, I forget what it's called, the offset. And you can have it so that when you click and drag, it offsets from wherever you started clicking and dragging, or you can change it to a global offset so that when you place one, it'll be lined up with the global grid of all the other ones of the same blueprint. Like, it's just so cool. I love blueprints. I think they're really well done in Factorio. My only gripe is that with remote view and needing to drop all your items before you go to space, my only gripe is that blueprints are still items that default to going into your inventory. I think they should default to going into your blueprint library, because that's how most games deal with blueprints, is there's just a blueprint library. That's all there is. And I understand why they need to be items, both for legacy reasons and for mods that use them as items, like recursive blueprints. That's all fine. It just shouldn't default to going there. It should default to being in your library. And so if you, because right now, a common thing I'll do is I'll copy a section, I'll plop it onto my hotbar so that I can use that planner or blueprint or whatever, or deconstruction planner. And then I'll hit Q to get the item out of my hand, and then it put it in my inventory. And I think it really should have gone into the library, not my inventory. So that's one improvement I think could be made. Oh yeah, Aelor, the quality of life, that now that we can change the offsets of a blueprint with the shift arrow keys, super awesome. Super duper awesome. The upgrade planner gets an A. It doesn't get an S because of quality shenanigans are really annoying to do with the upgrade planner. You can't do like any building of uncommon quality upgrade to that same building but of rare quality. Like, you can't do that. And you really need to be able to do that, I think. So the upgrade planner gets knocked down a peg because of space age quality, but in general, it's right up there with these guys in its usefulness. You tend not to use it as much as well, which is why I think A rather than S makes sense. Yeah, the blueprinting system in Factorio is incredible, and I love it. And I think it's part of the reason for Factorio's success. Ooh, the mining drill. Where does the mining drill go? I mean, let's get our three drills out here. The burner drill, I think, is not quite the same situation as these two. The reason they're different is that they have different functionality. Their footprints are different. One of them needs to be fueled and the other doesn't, right? That, like, there's a very different feel. Whereas these two are functionally the same. Yes, this has two modules, this one doesn't, but like, games that turn this into a burner assembler, I actually like that progression better. But this being an electric assembler and this also being electric makes it feel like it's kind of an unnecessary upgrade that you get really soon into the game. I do think this is one of those arguments where I'm a jaded player with 2,000 hours. A new player to the game is going to spend a lot more hours with gray assemblers, and they're going to feel really good about upgrading to blue assemblers when they finally get there, because it takes a lot of gameplay to even get to green science when you're new and it's your first time. So there's definitely a reason for them existing, I will say. But as a jaded player who's played for thousands of hours, I say do away with the gray. You know, like, it's fine. But burner drills don't quite feel like as useless. And they feel a little fun to make the burner drills that feed each other with coal. That's kind of fun. So from a vibe check way, I think burner drills deserve to be a C. They do their job. They do what they need to do. You do replace them as soon as you can, but they don't feel as useless as like a burner inserter or another thing. But at the same time, you never touch them again. Once you're past them, you never use them. There are almost zero reasons to use a burner drill. I mean, you have to fight pretty hard to think of even one. So I'm gonna put them in D for that reason. I think Regular drills get a B because they're just they're the workhorse. They're the workhorse of Factorio. And it's a little less true now that we have oil oceans, we have ammonia oceans, we have Gleba agriculture towers. You know, so it's a little less true that these are the only way to get resources. But before those things, this was kind of the only way you got anything was a drill. Now there are other methods. But I think it gets a B. It's the workhorse. It does a great job. You can wire it up to make Extendo blueprints when you play Clastorphobia. That's not a vanilla reason, but I don't know. But does that bring it above C? Yeah, I think it does. But the big drills get an A. The big drills are awesome. I mean, they've got a low resource drain, so they basically last forever. The effect of quality on these things is nuts. You know, an uncommon one gives you like 20 or 30% more ore from a patch than a regular one. They stack the items on top of the belt automatically for you. You don't even need a stack inserter. Like, just the list goes on. The huge area outside of the drill, they've got four tiles of a radius outside of the hitbox of the drill, so you can fit beacons in between them and still mine the whole patch. Oh, it's just chef's kiss. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. I love the big drills. I think they're actually too powerful in terms of the quality effect. I think the quality effect is a little bit too strong as you're working up the ranks. I think starting at 50% is fine, but the legendaries are only like, what, 7% drain or 9% drain or something? And I think that's like a little bit too far down the road of ridiculousness. 8%. So that's 12.5x multiplier, whereas a regular one is only a 2x multiplier. So that feels like that ramp is a little too steep. That being said, it doesn't really matter because, you know, you've already got the productivity bonuses that you're researching anyway. So between that and these, you end up having a lot of ore, and it's great. What else? Accumulators? Sure. Accumulators are, I think they're a C. They do what you need them to do. I have few complaints. And I actually think they did something cool with accumulators where the power rate finally matters on Fulgora. Whereas that's never really mattered before. Like in most contexts before Fulgora existed, the rate at which an accumulator could charge or drain almost never really mattered unless you had like a lot of laser turrets and only a few accumulators or something. Because for the most part, their capacity is such that if you have enough accumulators to handle the capacity you need, then there's more than enough input and output as well. But with the Fulgora lightning strikes happening, now that rate actually matters. And I think that's cool. On that note, solar panels. No notes. They do what you need to do. I think Space Age did a good job making it so that solar panels weren't just the solution everywhere. I like that. It's also realistic in space. The further away you go from the sun, the less power you get. So that was all good, but I don't really have a reason to bring it up higher. I don't think. Yeah, not so much. Boilers are another solid workhorse of the mid game. I think you feed them with coal, you can feed them with solid fuel later, and they're still going strong. I mean, you can do the whole game on steam power, you know, if you really want to. That might be less true now in Space Age, but I think it's still true. I think these guys get a C. Especially with the new water mechanics and the new steam mechanics, it's even easier. Yeah, I guess heating towers are kind of a new contender to take over. That is interesting. Water can be a pain in some places. That is true. The new fluid mechanics make it easier, though. Like, before, I think water in general, or steam in general, was a little weaker because of how much water you needed and the flow rates of pipes were lower. But now that's quite a bit better. What else? Let's kind of keep going with some of these similar ideas. So we'll do like the turbine, the pump jack. We get the power options going here. Fusion. That thing, these things. Okay. So moving on to the super boiler. I like the heat mechanic. It has its issues. I wish there were like underground heat pipes or higher throughput heat pipes, or some combination of those. But I actually really like heat in general, so I'm gonna put those at a B. I think it's a cool mechanic that the heat actually flows between pipes. Now that fluids don't actually flow between pipes, we gotta have something flowing. So now heat is our fluid that actually flows. And I just think it's really cool that like the temperature is representing power, right? Like a 600 degree pipe is holding more energy in it than a 500 degree pipe, and that energy is actually exchanged with the water to turn into steam that makes the same amount of power. It's just all really cool. It reminds me of oxygen not included and like all the cool math you do with like heat capacity and temperature change and all that nonsense, and I really like it. And I think nuclear just deserves to be right there with it, as well as the steam turbines. I almost want to knock these down slightly, because why did they have to make it so the ratio of these is not 1-to-2? And it's so close to 1-to-2. I think that's the reason I question it. If it was further away from 1-to-2, like it was maybe 1-to-2.7 or something, that would be one thing. But it's like 1-to-2.2 or 2.1. It like, it's really close to the point where you need, I can't remember if it's slightly more or slightly less. I think it's slightly less than two of these. I don't know why I can't remember which way it goes, but whichever way it is, it feels so close to being exactly two that they might as well have made it two. Because if it's that close, what's the point? It was one of those things where it's like, I'm fine with it being a different ratio, but then make it more different rather than it's really close. Just, I don't know. Regardless, I think it deserves a B rating. The nuclear and heat system is really cool. The heating towers are interesting. A new addition to Space Age. I kind of am with whoever was saying they just completely make boilers irrelevant. That is interesting, because it's true. But I also kind of like that there's a better way to make fuel turn into power, because it kind of was like, well, you do this or you don't do anything. But now we can use these, which have extra efficiency. And obviously, like on Gleba, they're really important to trash stuff. On Aqualo, they're important to trash extra solid fuel. I think they're pretty cool. But do they deserve a B? I don't know. I think I'll leave them at C. I don't have a good reason to bring them up. This is probably because the default temperature is 15. Maybe, but I guess if they're wanting to use a nice even number of steam, then yes. And you want the nice temperature to be 500, then yes, the amount of power it makes is going to be weird. One of the numbers is going to have to be weird. The temperature could be 515 instead, though, to fix it. Or the amount of steam it consumes could be a weirder number to make the ratio 1-to-2 for those. Anyway, fusion. Continuing on with the power mechanics. Fusion was cool. I really like the new fusion mechanic. I think the fact that it self-throttles is really neat. It's completely cost-effective to make the fusion cells. the plasma recycling loop is cool, that you have to cool something. It's cool. You have to cool it off. The fact that the fusion generators have to touch other fusion generators and you can't connect things with pipes is neat. So overall, fusion reactors get an A. I don't think they get an S because they're just not really that necessary. By the time you get them, the game's almost over. They're very much an end game thing rather than a like necessary part of your playthrough. So as far as the usefulness measure, the time is not up there. You know, this little menu is annoying that it pops up every time I click on it. But yeah, so I think because you have them for such a short time before victory, it's not quite S tier. Because we're not ranking things like how useful are they for your mega base, right? If that's what we were ranking things on, then fusion would probably be S. All right, moving on. Let's do the other minor type thing. So the drill, pump jack. Pump jack does what you need it to do. I don't really have any thoughts on it. It can hold modules. You can beacon them just like miners. I don't know. I got nothing. They're fine. Agricultural towers. Now, these things are sweet. I love the way they look. The graphics are really cool. The fact that they plant the trees and then they grow and then they harvest it. It's like a really... It's way cooler than mining. I will say that. So I think it deserves a B or even an A for that. I might give it an A because it's just so freaking cool. I really like the agricultural towers. It does feel weird that you don't need to irrigate or give any compost or anything, you know, but that's a mod thing. It actually, people have guessed, and I think they're guessing accurately, that used to be a mechanic because the agricultural tower has a pipe connection at the bottom. So I'm guessing you needed to feed it water at some point, or maybe even some sort of nutrient liquid or something. But no longer that is the case, probably for simplicity's sake. What to go to here? The old lab? Or I guess we should finish off the collection mechanics. Offshore pump. Offshore pumps I find particularly boring. I think they're so simple, it's just kind of like a checkbox. There's nothing interesting about them. And I think that's true on every single planet you build them on. Like on Nauvis, okay, well, I guess you put an offshore pump to get some water and then you connect it up and you just have to build close to water. On Vulcanus, well, I guess you have to build close to lava to get your lava, but now you can just pump lava for... I don't know. It's just an offshore pump I don't think is interesting. It's necessary. I'm not knocking it in the sense that I think they shouldn't exist in the game. I just wish they were more... there was more nuance and play to it than there currently is. Because right now it's kind of just a checkbox item. So, yeah, I don't know. I wish there was more to it. It's just kind of a boring thing. But yeah, let's talk about labs. Labs are such an interesting game because research in this game is such an interesting thing. You know, the idea of feeding tech packs instead of researching in a different way. Like a lot of games would have research labs and a tech tree, but the research labs kind of contribute the research points naturally. So the fact that the labs have to actually be fed with certain items to do the research is... I know at this point it's kind of a norm in gaming, but I think back when this game started, that wasn't a norm. This it is kind of a newer mechanic. I have no negative things to say about labs. They do what they need to do. They look really cool. Disco Science is fun if you have that mod. but yeah, I don't know. Labs are kind of just what they are, you know. I don't have anything bad to say about them. But I do wish the Biter Labs could go places other than Nauvis. That's kind of an interesting topic. We haven't talked about it a lot yet in this stream, but just the railroading that Space Age does just overall as a topic is interesting to talk about, because Vanilla Factorio did not do much railroading at all. And there, you know, there are some tiny places where you can argue that it's railroading, but Space Age has railroaded you in quite a few ways. With, and what I mean by railroading is generally, and it can be used in a bit of a flexible way, but generally it means you are adding a restriction that is artificial. Like, the fact that you can only place these on Nauvis is simply a checkbox that they could uncheck. It is an artificial restriction. Now, it could have lore reasons, it could have, like, reasons that it makes sense, or it could even have reasons that it's gonna make the game more fun. All of that's irrelevant to the fact that it is railroading, though. Like, railroading is railroading. It's something you can define. And only being able to put these on Nauvis is railroading. Whether it's good or not is a different question. I just want to make sure we're, like, being clear when we communicate. Like, this is railroading. The question is it fun? Is it good? Should it be the way it is? Right? And that's up for discussion. I think it's interesting because if you didn't, to the BioLab specifically, if you didn't force them on Nauvis, pretty much everybody would put them on Glaba, right? Because then Glaba wouldn't need to worry about the spoil time on the agricultural science packs. You'd get a higher rate of them, and you would transport all your other science to Glaba. I actually think that's cooler, and maybe this is just a me thing. I think it would have been cooler to make the transition of, oh, now I ship all my science from Nauvis to Glaba, rather than, and then Glaba would be the only planet you don't ship science off of. You're shipping science off of every planet. I don't think shipping science off of a planet is that cool of a mechanic. And the agricultural packs last for an hour, and that's long enough that even with a pretty inefficient space platform setup, you're still able to get packs pretty consistently. It's just a question of, are you getting the packs, like, I'm comparing the world where you're doing the science on Glaba versus shipping at home. Maybe if you ship at home to Nauvis, the packs are all at 40%. And if you did the science right there on Glaba, the packs would be at 80%. It works either way. Like, yes, you need to ship more packs if they're at 40%. And that's a pretty conservative estimate. Like, they're probably going to be higher than 40% in most cases without that much work, even. And that being said, it's like, would it really have been that much? Like, it is cool that you have to ship something that's spoiling. I think that concept is neat. But I actually think at the end of the day, it ends up just working out because the spoil time is long enough that you don't really have to fight that hard to get agricultural packs to Nauvis. And if you're not getting enough, you just ship more of them. You don't, because your ship is already, it, what I'm trying to say is it's not hard to get your ship shuttling science within that 1 hour window. And once you've done that, then it's just a question of sending more if you don't have enough. And I actually think it would have been more interesting to have to ship all the science that you've made on Nauvis over to Glaba, because that's actually, you know, now you're dealing with lots of production lines, and you're dealing with, what, 5 science packs? Red, green, military, yellow, purple, and space, which is being made in space, usually above Nauvis. Then you might make that over Glaba, and so you move that platform. I actually think there would have been a lot more interesting gameplay going on if these could only be made on Glaba, or even just they let you make them on Glaba. Because I think a lot of players would actually still put them on Nauvis just because it's less work, because all their science is already on Nauvis. So transporting everything to Glaba would have been a bigger project. A lot of people wouldn't do it. But then if you do, now you have your Glaba science not being spoiled very fast. I don't know. I, for whatever reason, with the way it plays out in my head, I think making these restricted to Nauvis is a choice that's not actually adding fun. It's actually forcing a solution where a lot of players would have done that solution anyway. And the other options, while they might be more effective for like a late game thing, they also have a high cost to them. So it provides an interesting, what's the word I'm looking for? Not give or take, kind of a give or take. It's a trade-off. I think it's actually an interesting trade-off if these could be built anywhere, because then you're like, where do I want to put my science facility? And it's kind of a big pain in the butt to move it off of Nauvis. But if you do the pain in the butt thing, it might pay you off because you get more Glaba science. I don't know. Anyway, very interesting topics. There's a similar argument for, like, should you be able to make green belts on other planets than Vulcanus or some things like that? Or not a similar argument, but a similar, like, conversation topic. And I think some people really don't like the restrictions. Other people really like them. I'm somewhere in the middle. I think a lot of the restrictions they have make sense and I think make the game more fun. I think some of them, like this one, as I've talked about it, I think I'm like, I don't know if I'm on board with that restriction. I think it's kind of made, it's removed a player choice that I think would have actually been an interesting one and not just a boring, players always do X, so that's boring and not fun, so we'll remove the option for X. I actually don't think it would have been that. Okay, on to beacons. I want to talk about beacons. Beacons are so cool. I think they do struggle from the issue of, like, the optimal game being more beacons than assemblers. I don't love that, which is why I, and I think a lot of people, actually really liked the space exploration version where you could only have one beacon. The problem with that, though, is it did still encourage building in grids. I kind of wish for a middle ground where you have the space exploration beacons, but if two beacons are affecting one building, it still works. It just doesn't receive the effect of one of them. And I don't know how the building would pick, and that would be a little complicated, but the thing that was annoying about the space exploration one was that when they overlapped, it was actually detrimental, and so it literally forced you to build this grid based rectangle overlap. Otherwise you're actually turning off buildings, and that was kind of annoying. And so that was the issue I had with the SE ones. If there was a way, and I don't have a great solution in my head, because like I was just saying, you could make it so it only receives the effects from one building or one beacon, but then which one would it receive? You could just make it so it doesn't receive any beacon effects if there's more than one beacon, but it still works. That might have been fine. All that being said, I really like the changes they made in Space Age, because now you can just build one or two beacons and you get not most of the effect, but you get a lot of the effect that you would get from eight beacons, and rather than just a fourth of the effect if you built two. So I really like the changes. I think they're really great. I think beacons offer a cool way to speed things up in the late game. I do find them, you know, from a game design perspective, I could see a world where not having beacons in your game could actually make it better in some ways, but I really like them. I think they've worked out well for Factorio. So I'm going to give them a B tier because they're really cool and I like them and I think they're very helpful. You rush them, like the rush factor is pretty high. The cost effectiveness is pretty high. You use them for the rest of the game. So I think beacons are pretty great. And quality beacons are insanely strong, yeah. All right. Do we want to go towards the module side of the conversation? The smelter side of the conversation? Let's do repair packs. That's kind of a random one. repair packs are fine. They do what you need to do. I don't know. They're kind of one of those weird items that feels out of place in Factorio. What if bots could just repair buildings and they didn't need packs to do it? Would that actually be a problem? I don't think so. I don't know. It's one of those things like blueprints being items in your inventory where it feels like, you know how the axe used to be an item that you'd equip to go mining and you could get a steel axe, you know, to mine faster. And then at some point they kind of were like, why are we doing this anymore? Does this really have a purpose? I kind of feel like repair packs are in that category. Like, they're totally fine. They do what they need to do. They repair your buildings. but they're so cheap that it really kind of doesn't matter. You know, like they're just a couple of iron and copper and you're done. And so you can just make them in the thousands. And then at that point, they kind of might as well not exist at all. So it comes back to that argument of like, are they worth it for the very short window of time in the early game where their cost isn't zero? And I don't have the best answer for that, but I personally think the game would be fine without them if bots could just repair buildings for free. I don't really think that would change much. It would just be one less thing to automate, you know? And at some point, if you remove too many things, you don't have enough things to automate. But anyway. Okay, so let's do modules before buildings. I think I want to do it that way. Because the rest of the buildings are all, with the exception of the recycler, they're all processing buildings. And I guess the biter nest is kind of unique too. So, modules, huh? How do we do this? Do we do one color at a time or one tier at a time? I think we do one tier at a time. So we'll start with speed one. I'm gonna give speed one a B because they're such a nice boost when you first get them. And it also feels relatively fair in terms of they do boost the power requirements of things by a lot. And it feels like that's a stage of the game where you probably don't have a ton of extra power. And so these are a real trade-off to put them in things. But it feels pretty good to do so. I think productivity one feels about the same for me. Like, they're really nice. You get just a little bit of productivity. Not a ton. It's only 4%. And you usually only have blue assemblers at that point. So it's really only 8% more. But 8% more feels really good to get for free. You know, but they're using a lot more power. And efficiency one, I'm ranking them a little higher only because of my recent Death World playthrough and I saw the need for them. They're very nice for putting in your mining drills and it's an easy place to save power and pollution. They're also more helpful because of beacons having a stronger effect at only a couple of them. So you could do like two beacons around a building with two speed ones in one beacon and then a mixture in the other one, and that helps cut back a little bit on power. But that being said, I don't think it gets higher than a B. Now, quality. Quality modules feel like the conversation of quality as a whole goes along with them, but I'll try to grade them a little bit more independent of the quality mechanic. Quality ones are kind of bad. It's such a low chance. You only use these to have a shot at getting a couple uncommons, right? Like, and maybe you'll be blessed by your lucky stars and get a rare. But for the most part, Q1s are just, they're just a C. They just exist to get you a couple uncommons and hope for the best. Nothing more than that. And even higher quality ones are still pretty bad. So that's where those land. On to tier 2 modules. Speed 2s are the workhorse of the mid game. They do what you need to do, but at that point, they kind of feel like, I don't know, I think they just get a C. They just solidly do what you want them to do. And once you get quality, you can get some higher quality speed 2s, and that's starting to get kind of strong, but they're still not crazy great. Prod 2s. I think prod modules just in general are really strong, so I'm going to put those at a B level just because now you can start mixing prod 2s with speed 2 beacons to keep things going fast enough, but then your power usage is starting to skyrocket, so at that point you're hoping for nuclear. Like, there's a lot of give and take there, but the other hard part about module 2s is they're so expensive at that stage of the game. Excuse me, my throat's a little sore today, so I probably should be drinking more water. But yeah, anyway, Efficiency twos, I'm gonna put it D tier, because like, you kind of, you either need them or you don't, and most of the time you don't. Every rare once in a while you might put some efficiency twos somewhere, but I feel like you're kind of, you already have efficiency threes by the time you care, or you're just using efficiency ones. And yeah, we already talked about like, tier two modules are kind of expensive at the point where you can first make them, so you're probably not making these. It just these always feel expensive. If these were way cheaper than the other tier two modules, I think I might make some of them sometimes, but they're not cheaper, so I don't make them. Q2, these are the workhorse of early quality. You know, you're not seeing the Q3s until after you're done with Fulgora. I don't know if they deserve a B tier though. I think they still kind of do what they need to do. Now you've got, once you have these, you also have assembler threes, and so you can get four of the Q2 modules, and now you're starting to actually get a real chance, you know, to get a decent amount of uncommons and even some rares. And then you can also roll for higher quality Q2 modules, at which point you really start to see the benefits. So I feel like quality two is when you finally start to feel like you can play with the mechanic, at least a medium amount. Until you get recyclers, that's still sort of not true, but yeah. Q2s exist only to make 5 boxes full of asteroid grabbers. Yes, yeah, exactly. So you can get some uncommon asteroid collectors. But yeah, I actually, here's another hot take. I liked the quality mechanic more before I got recyclers and before I unlocked epic and legendary. I thought it was actually really interesting and fun on those early hours of just being on Nalvis, not having recyclers and figuring out what I wanted to do with quality there. I thought that was a more interesting, like, give and take. The Gambletron loop is really cool, but it is kind of like, well, if I just want higher quality, then I have to go down this rabbit hole of solving this problem with some form of Gambletron production recycling loop. I do like how complex that particular challenge is. I don't know if I like the number of different quality tiers there are, and it gums up your inventory. And I talked about that in my review. It's just kind of, it kind of bloats things. It bloats the game a bit. And it's kind of, there are some really suave solutions that you wish you could do, but you can't do, because you can't just have, you know, you can't just have an assembler make, like, it can't interchange lower quality or higher quality items for the same thing. So you have to, it's all got to be exactly that. And that means you have to do finicky stuff for solutions. Anyway, that's more talking about the quality mechanic as a whole. So back to modules. Speed threes get an A, maybe even an S. These things, I mean, they're, you need them everywhere, right? Like, you need things to go fast. However, with the new buff to beacons and quality on modules and beacons and assemblers, they're not as I think these would have been S in Factorio 1.1 before Space Age. I think I'm going to knock them down to A, though. They feel less necessary, and you need less of them, because now your building already is going way faster without even having a speed module. So, like, a higher quality assembler, you know, with higher quality prod modules is probably going faster than a non-quality assembler with non-quality prod modules, even with some speed beaconing going on. So it's really interesting. Yeah. S3A because P3S. Those are all letters that I somehow understood. all right, E3, it gets a C. It's really helpful when you want it. At the time you're finally making them, they're fairly cheap, and you're gonna use some of them in some places, like on a space platform if you're trying to save power, or you mix one or two in with higher quality levels so that your foundries are taking 10 megawatts instead of 20 megawatts a piece. You know, like, the power usage numbers do start to get kind of astronomically huge, and if you're not building large fusion plants, you might actually need some. I definitely used some of these, so I'll keep them at C. I think they do their job. But yeah, the obvious S tier is prod 3. so freaking good. I mean, free stuff. Like, you can't complain about that. Yeah, it costs you more power and time, but you can make up for that with these guys and every once in a while these guys and quality, because higher quality stuff is always giving you the benefits without the downsides. So like a higher quality speed module is in fact kind of like an efficiency module, because it's giving you more speed than it's costing you power, which is actually saving you power, which is crazy. That being said, I think the Q3 modules, I think they also get a C. Like they, you need them for doing a Gambletron, but you don't need a Gambletron. And yeah, I agree, Aloy. Like, these aren't even that much better than Q2s. I ran into that issue where like an epic Q2, or was it a rare Q2, was better than an uncommon Q3, or they're like the same. Like, basically these are just like one quality level higher equivalent, and they cost so much more. So really the Q3s are kind of for that end game mega base and late game stuff, but you don't need them. And if your only goal is to get some uncommon, maybe a little bit of rare stuff to throw onto your space platform, your higher quality Q2s are already going to get that job done. So I think that makes sense. All right, moving on, let's talk about recyclers now. Recyclers are, I have so many mixed thoughts, because I think they do what they need to do. Like, that's a C tier thing. I think it's B tier because they dump stuff straight onto belts, which is really cool. I like having a mixture of buildings that dump stuff onto belts versus those that don't. I also really like that they are deterministic for item counts over 4. I actually, at that point, I almost wish they had taken it, and I don't think it would work in the game engine, but if we're dreaming of for ponies, I wish they had taken it half a step further where it was just completely deterministic, where let's say you were recycling a building that required one engine. These don't require engines, but let's say a steam engine cost you one engine to craft and you put it in a recycler. I wish it would work like productivity, where it filled the engine bar 1/4 of the way after recycling one, and then after you've recycled 4 steam turbines, it would give you back exactly one engine. Because that's how it works for item counts that are multiples of 4, is it is that deterministic. If a item requires 20 of something, the recycler will give you back 5 of them, exactly 1/4. So I kind of wish it worked that way for everything. Again, I realize the game engine wouldn't support it with the way the game works and stuff, but I'm dreaming for ponies, and that's the pony that I want. That being said, it's really great. It does what you want it to do. A lot of people have always wanted the recycler mod. I mean, we've had mods that do it just that, where they're like, oh, I made a bunch of this building and I no longer need this building. I wish I could turn them all back into their pieces. And now you can. It's very cool. The fact that you can put quality modules in them is an interesting, like, it complexifies the whole recycling quality loop thing by a lot. I'm still not sure where I land on all that. I have some, like, is that actually good? It's cool, but is it good? but yeah, I think recyclers are A. They're pretty sweet. I like the design. I really like Fulgora using them as the production mechanic. That almost feels like a separate thing, though. It almost feels like they could have made that a separate building to process the Fulgora scrap rather than use recyclers. So it's kind of like two buildings in one. Very sad that you can't prod the recyclers. That would be probably bad. All right, Stone Furnace probably gets a C. It does what you need to do, but you upgrade as soon as you can to steel. But steel is actually kind of expensive. Like, when you first unlock steel furnaces, it's a lot of steel and a lot of stone brick, right? I think it's steel and stone brick, which you don't have in huge amounts yet. Ironically, stone furnaces don't use stone brick, even though they're clearly made out of stone bricks. They only use regular stone, which I always thought was kind of funny. But the steel furnaces use stone brick. So I don't think steel furnaces actually are a immediate great replacement for stone furnaces. Sometimes you keep using stone furnaces for a while. So I think they belong in C rather than D for that. And I think steel furnaces, I mean, they're a workhorse. I think they get a B. They're awesome. You can replace them in place over the stone furnaces. So you just easily doubling. It's around the same time that you've got red belts. And so you can take a full yellow belt production with stone furnaces and boom, transform it to red belts and steel furnaces and blue inserters. You probably don't need blue inserters for steel furnaces, but you could. And now everything's like the same, but twice as fast. It just feels really good. So I think steel furnaces get a B. Electric furnaces, I have always hated these stupid things. They're 3x3. They only take 2 modules, which feels really wimpy compared to the other buildings. They don't go any faster than steel furnaces. They take twice as much power as steel furnaces. So you're actually inefficiently costing you power. And so these things suck until you have huge amounts of beacons and modules and all sorts of other stuff. So I'm gonna knock them down to D. I never liked electric furnaces. It always felt like they were later game than they were, if that makes any sense. Like, you didn't really use them when you unlocked them. And it felt like they were kind of off limits until you had beacons and modules and lots of power, right? Because they suck so much power, and then you start beaconing and moduling them to make them a little bit better for the size that they are. But then at that point, you're using like hundreds of megawatts, and so you really can't use them until you have nuclear, is kind of what it felt like. Yeah, so that's my take there. Let's see. Foundries, though. I mean, all the new stuff. Let's save the new buildings for... We'll do all 4 of these in a row. So let's do chem plants. Chem plants, I mean, chem plants and oil refineries kind of feel like C's to me. They do what they need to do. They've got 3 modules each, so it's kind of low, but still 3. So it's not as bad as the furnaces. Know if I have any notes. Process your oil. This is kind of unrelated, but the ability to flip them now is super nice. So that's great. Yeah, exactly, Nursten. Exactly. But I don't think that means these get ranked higher because of it, but it is nice. Yeah, I don't know. I think they do what they need to do. I don't really have a ton of thoughts on them. Which, again, is kind of what you want as a developer, is for someone to play your game, use the things, and you ask them at the end, how was that? And you're like, honestly, I got no notes. It was great. You know, or it was adequate. It was fine. I don't even know if great is the right word, because that makes it sound like I have things that made it feel great, but it just felt completely normal. I didn't think about it at all. So that's a C. Captive biters. This almost feels like it should be 2, because there's the captive biters that you capture, and then there's the captive biters that you create. How the captive biters as a mechanic, it was kind of weird. It kind of came out of nowhere. Like, they didn't even add it to the game until, well, they might have been planning it for a long time, but it was added pretty late in the process. How do I feel about it, though? I thought it was cool. I didn't like having to use biter eggs for these, because it meant you couldn't use the same blueprints that you use for the other Q3 modules, and that felt a little weird. That feels like something a mod pack would do. Like, Pyanodons is like, hey, we want to help it so that all your metal production doesn't feel like the same blueprint for iron, copper, tin and lead. I think that's really great. The problem is Factorio didn't do that. These 3 are exactly the same. Q3, E3, and S3, exactly the same. And then P3, not the same. And that felt unnecessary. I almost think it would have been good to have an intermediate that you make with biter eggs, and then that doesn't spoil. So then you can use the same blueprint for all 4 of your tier 3 modules. That complaint aside, I thought it was really cool to capture the biters and like collect biter eggs by using the bioflux that you import from Glaybutt. Like, I actually did like that. I think that's a cool loop. And needing that to make the bio labs was cool. So I think overall it's pretty neat. I think for like innovation sense, it gets a B for me. It's actually really cool. The vibe is really cool. I do have some complaints about the biter eggs, but that's more about the eggs than this itself as a capture mechanic and this making the eggs. That was all fine. Excuse me. All right. Now we're getting down to brass tacks. Centrifuges. They're really slow and they only can do two modules, and I never liked that. D tier. They're also the only thing that can deal with uranium, but we already said necessity doesn't increase the grade. Just the fact that you need them doesn't give them good grades. D tier. Okay, here we go. These are the big four. These are the big four. So, oh, you know what? F for centrifuge. I'm going to go down to F because I just thought one more thing about them. The recipe. It feels like a different human made the recipes for the nuclear related stuff and the rest of Factorio. It is so gobsmackingly different when you look at all the recipes for buildings and you look at a centrifuge. I need to look it up. Centrifuge Factorio. It's so weird to me. Like 100 red circuits, 100 concrete, 100 gears, and 50 steel. Nothing else costs anything like that other than the nuclear plant, which costs... And then the like heat exchanger stuff costs a billion copper plates, but otherwise isn't that crazy. I don't know. It just... Centrifuges have always felt weirdly expensive to me. And I just haven't quite understood. It's just felt not balanced in a way that made sense. So I give centrifuges an F for that reason. Yeah, the rocket silo is expensive, but that feels reasonable. The building is huge. It's 10 by 10 or 12 by 12 or whatever. The centrifuge is 3 by 3. It doesn't look that much bigger. It doesn't seem that much denser. You know, our assemblers are only costing like 9 gears and 5 circuits. And then this thing's over here costing 100 gears and 100... circuits and 50 steel, and it's like, why? And 100 concrete? Why? It could have been 20 concrete. Yeah, it does make it a big investment, but the problem is you still... It's a different... It's like having Pyanodons inside of regular Factorio. Like, I like that the building is a bigger investment, but it's just weird that only these have that applying to them. I think they're trying to figure out, like, well, how many are you going to need? You're only going to need, like, 10 of these. So we want it so that building 10 of these feels pretty expensive, which means one of them needs to be pretty expensive, too. Whereas the other buildings, like furnaces, you're going to need hundreds of them, so it's fine if they're not individually, like, crazy expensive. So I can see how it's still relatively balanced, but it feels weird to me. I don't know. Vibe check doesn't pass. Okay. EMP, cryogenic plant, biochamber, and foundry. It's hard to give these bad grades because they're awesome. I love all the new buildings. Even you, biochambers. We'll talk more about it, but I love them all. Can I put them all in S tier? Maybe not, but like... Maybe I can, because like all the metal you get, the molten metal is cool. I really like foundries. I do think there's too many exclusive to Vulcanus recipes, but that doesn't really have that much to do with foundries. I think foundries being exclusive to Vulcanus is fine. They're a bit OP. Yes, they are. But that's why things go into S tiers, because they're OP. To be fair, some of that is why we're tier listing it, right? Like, they are ridiculously strong. The only knock to their strength in the game is needing calcite, but they need such a small amount of calcite that it's very easy to transport that around. Or in the later game, it's very easy to just grab it from space and send it down. once you have the advanced reprocessing recipe. So I do think foundries get an S. EMPs, also S. I mean, these are insanely good, even more so than the foundries, because like they don't even need the calcite, right? And they just give you the free 50% productivity. The downside is the input, they can be a little trickier because like the fluid inputs aren't centered, and if you're trying to, I mean, these are kind of the same way where if you're replacing a smelting line, you're just going to need to rebuild it. But these are more of a direct replacement for an assembling machine in the sense that they have the exact same recipes. These have the whole new recipe of molten, and so you kind of have to think a whole new process. But these are replacing the same process where it's like, oh yeah, you need the same ingredients and it still makes a green chip, but it just makes free ones on top of having a much faster base speed. So pretty great. They cost a lot of power. I think is actually a very real downside that I don't know if it totally balances them out, but it helps balance them out a little bit because the cost is pretty huge of the power requirement. Once you start beaconing them and moduling them, they take like 20, 30 megawatts all of a sudden. And the same is true for foundries, but I think you feel it even more for the electromagnetic plants. I don't know if it's enough of a negative to make them balanced because they are just great to use, but I loved them. Cryogenic plant, also S. It looks really cool. I think it's my favorite graphically of all of them. And having 8 slots for modules is really cool. And this is basically a straight upgrade over the chem plant for most things. And then biochamber gets a B. It's cool. But it's kind of only cool on Glaba. And this is the big difference. These three, you can use them anywhere with very little issues except for needing calcite for the foundry. But again, you need such a small amount. It's hard to overstate how tiny of an amount you need. And that really makes it almost feel like not a cost at all. It's to the point where you can send one manual shipment and it will literally last you for like 10 hours or something, you know, when you're doing smaller amounts. And if you're doing larger amounts, it's usually easier to actually automate some amount of calcite. Whereas this guy actually needs quite a few nutrients, and nutrients spoil in 5 minutes. So you can't just have them ready to go or on some ship. You have to actually like deal with some sort of automation loop where you're constantly transporting bioflux, or you're doing some craziness where you make, you know, an item that you then recycle to turn back into something that you can then turn into nutrients. Like, yes, there's weird workarounds like that, but that's absolute, you know, nonsense, right? That's not just like an easy thing like calcite. That's what we're comparing it to, and it's nothing close to that. So yes, bioflux makes a lot of nutrients. It's easy, but the problem is you can't just plop down biochambers and just plop down a requester chest and put nutrients, right? That's what calcite is. That's how easy calcite is. And the problem here is that you then have to make the nutrients from the bioflux, which then means you have an extra processing step of making nutrients wherever you're using these, on top of needing to have bioflux, which is on Nauvis, but probably not on your other planets, and not in space, certainly. So it's way more effort to use these than the other three. And that makes it a pretty big difference. And back to this, you can think it's an uneducated opinion, Templar, but enforcing biolabs to Nauvis being vastly better gameplay-wise is certainly an opinion. There's no facts here. And my opinion is that having the choice to put science on other planets would be better gameplay. And I think the cost of putting science on other planets is actually a very real cost that a lot of players aren't going to do. It would be an interesting choice. It wouldn't just be like, oh, you obviously put science on Glaba. A lot of people wouldn't put science on Glaba because it's a pain in the butt to move all your science there. So it makes it an interesting choice. And restricting it actually makes it not like you removed an interesting choice from the players. And that's the point I'm making there. It's not just like trimming off the fat. Players were always doing it this one way only. So we trimmed off, you know, the one option that players are never going with. And that's where I think Wubo was trying to trim off options. And that's when it's good to trim off options as a developer. Like if players are always doing it one way, you might as well trim off the way they aren't doing it. Or if players are always doing it one way and it's not the fun way, you might have to nerf that, which is what they did for like laser turrets against Gleba enemies is a perfect. And we'll talk more about this in the military ranking section, but I think it's interesting to talk about here too, that like they made it so that laser turrets weren't really good against Gleba enemies because it was a very boring solution to just have a wall of laser turrets on Gleba. And while that does remove player choice, I think that's an example where removing player choice makes the game more interesting. I think that was a good choice that they removed lasers from being this perfect, easy solution on Gleba. I have a different complaint about Gleba enemies, but we'll get there on the military tab. So here we are. This is it. Our automation tab has been tier listed. Again, you know, you guys leave comments, argue with me. I love it. That's the fun of this, is we all get to have our different opinions. And again, so much of this is vibe based, on top of so much of it being even play style based, right? Like people with different play styles, maybe they've never built nuclear once in their lives, so why would they put nuclear at B tier? You know, like there, so much of it is even based on how we play as players. Some people didn't even touch the quality mechanic. Some people played tons with it. I was somewhere in the middle. I played quite a bit with it, but I certainly didn't go crazy hard on it. But yeah, I've loved a lot of the new Space Age stuff. I do think these new buildings being S tier is kind of what you want, given that they're meant to be really good and powerful. That's the reward you get for beating those planets, which is pretty cool. So yeah, I don't know. I think overall, this says some good things, that this is where I landed after playing Space Age, because most of the Space Age stuff is higher, which is pretty cool. But anyway, I'm gonna keep streaming, so if you're here live, stick around. But for those of you from the future YouTube recording, thank you so much for watching. Let me know what you think in the comments, as always, and we'll be doing more of these in the coming days.